innovation, entrepreneurship, and global interconnectivity. Those are the three core values undergirding the mission of Washington State University at Rick. Peter Janicki personifies those three very important values. We are honored and pleased to have Peter Janicki be our first lecturer for the Innovation and Outreach Lecture Series. With that, let me say welcome. I want to welcome all of you to Washington State University Everett. It is a pleasure to have you here with us this evening, and we think that you are truly going to enjoy this opportunity to hear from Peter Janicki. As many of you may know, Washington State University Everett is only one campus within the Washington State University system. And with that, what I'd like to do is also welcome my colleagues and friends who are at our Spokane, Tri-Cities, Vancouver, and Pullman campuses. And in fact, I think we also have some of our extension locations that are tuning in tonight as well. So I want to say welcome to all of you. Something else that you might also know is that Washington State University Everett is the newest campus in the WSU system, with a focus on STEM, high demand degree programs, and also programs that are aligned with industry. We are really making a difference in the North Puget Sound. In fact, in the next 2 or 3 weeks, we will host our third annual commencement ceremony where we will confer almost 90 degrees to our class of 2018. That is something that we are extremely proud of. You know, we're also proud of the fact that we are able to host this lecture series right here in Everett. And I'd like to give a special thank you to President Kirk Schultz, who is sponsoring this particular effort. With that, I'd just like to say welcome to all of you. Welcome to Washington State University Everett. And I think you will be pleased with this presentation that you will receive this evening. And I know for one thing that you will learn a lot tonight. So with that, again, I'd like to say welcome. And I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Brian Kraft, who is the Assistant Vice President for Research and Innovation at WSU. And Dr. Kraft will now provide you some background information on Washington State University's research mission, and then he will do a formal introduction of Peter Janicki. Dr. Kraft?
This is the Innovation and Outreach Speaker Series. Just a word about the series. It really came out of an effort that we started in the WSU system to really take a close look at how we interface with our public constituents. We're land grant, we're present in every county across the state, but we also have a whole bunch of research in Pullman that is not getting out the way it should. So we decided to launch this series as recognition of the great things that people are doing in our communities, but also sometimes the great things that we're doing inside the university to really celebrate outreach and industry engagement like they're doing here in Everett. It's a great example. The energy of the people and the creativity of the programs is really fantastic. I'm excited working out at Pullman in the Office of Research to forge new partnerships here in the community. And I'm hoping that this presence here can really foster that. We have a lot of great work inside WSU. A lot of it relates to bioenergy and the problems that Peter Janicki is working to solve through Janicki Bioenergy. We have whole teams of people working on this waste energy problem. It is a hard nut to crack. I've been in roles in WSU that have ranged everywhere from sort of frontline technology evaluation in this bioenergy space, and I can't tell you how many things I've seen that don't work. It's really a hard problem. So we're really excited to have him here tonight, and we are really excited to learn about Peter Genneke's story and his experience turning waste into wealth.
I founded Genneke Industries in the early 90s, and it was predominantly a company that's been focused in aerospace. We do, as you can see, kind of just a real quick rundown of this company. We do a lot of work with Boeing. We do a lot of work with Lockheed Martin. We built a lot of these space crew modules. Pretty much anything that goes up in the air today, probably some part of it was built up at Genneke Industries, conceivably. That company currently has about 800 to 900 employees. About 5 years ago, there were a couple of people that came from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation through our facility. And they saw all this really creative stuff that we were doing in chemistry and carbon fiber composites, machining, and they asked a very simple question. Are you guys interested in helping us work on sanitation? And I said, what's the problem? If there's a solved problem, this is a solved problem. We've all used the toilet, they work great. Just flush the toilet, okay? Has it really changed in, 120 years? Okay, solved problem. Why should I spend my time working on this problem? But I knew they had some pretty smart people at the foundation, so I thought, you know what, I'll just go on. So I got on an airplane, left the United States, went to Africa for the first time in my life, and I ended up at this place, Nairobi. I also went to West Africa, went to South Africa, went to many places in Africa, and I saw pretty much the same thing. Population density that I had never seen before, and a sanitation problem that was significant. Inside every one of those little houses, not everyone, they have a toilet, and they have a concrete pit in the ground, and that's where they go to the bathroom. And as you can imagine, what do you think the groundwater looks like in that area? It's just horrendous. When these things fill up, they dig them out, they dump that material into garbage cans, sanitation solution for about a third of the population of the world today. So I looked at that and thought, wow, how about our sanitation solution, what we have in America? So this is a picture of Seattle. Same population, by the way, as that slum in Nairobi, 2.5 million people. And there's the wastewater treatment plant in Seattle. It's interesting if you think about this. That wastewater treatment plant doesn't make one single thing that you can sell. That seems really amazing to me that we could have something of that magnitude, spend that kind of money, and it makes nothing sellable, not one single thing. So here's the idea. All we have to do is figure out how to take that technology and fit it into Africa, India, Mexico, South America, all over the world, China, and we solve the world sanitation problem. Does that seem like a viable solution? Well, we've actually done this, okay? We have donors all over the world that are paying for wastewater treatment plants to be built in developing countries. And I went and I checked them, and they all look like this. They don't work. They're non-functional. These didn't even have water in them. When they build the wastewater treatment plants, they actually put a pipe around them. So after they build them, they can shut them off and just run the water around the plant. Because there's no purpose in running the plant. This doesn't make anything you can sell. Now they like building the plant because they get all this money from the United States to build the plant. So they love building the plants. They just don't love using them. This is interesting. You know, this is a picture of myself and some of my team up there and some people from the Gates Foundation. And they were actually really proud of this facility. That's why they brought us to this facility. This non-function. This was typical. We have an environmental problem. Okay. So in the United States, we have roughly 50 to 60 people per square mile. It's population density of the United States. The population density of India is 1,000 people per square mile. West Africa is processing 1,000 people per square mile. So we're talking 20 times the population density, and we have a solution that doesn't have enough water. Okay. So the lake, the picture up in the upper right-hand corner there is Lake Mead behind Hoover Dam. The last time it was full of water, was during the Reagan administration. And all that water gets pumped out of Lake Mead, goes to Los Angeles, they use it once, goes into that wastewater treatment plant, and about 20 others, and then goes into the ocean. I do a lot of work in aerospace, and so I kind of thought this was kind of a fun picture. 100 years of development in aerospace. Now look at 100 years of development in wastewater treatment plants. We figured out how to do this basically aerobic digestion, I don't know, 120 years ago, whatever. And that's what we do today. We also do anaerobic digestion. But fundamentally, nothing has changed. And I'm like, really? There's a lot of reasons. First of all, I don't think most people, when they're in third grade, think about, you know, this is what I want to do when I grow up. I want to work on wastewater treatment plants. The governments in the United States and the organizations that run this stuff are super, super opposed to any kind of risk. If they just do what everyone else is doing, they're going to be fine. If they do something innovative, remember, that pipe that's bringing the sewage never stops. Okay? Innovation will get you fired. Doing what everybody else does will never get you fired in that business. And since it's a public monopoly, there's no reason that you have to do it cheaper. So with funding from the Gates Foundation, I built this machine. And what's really neat about it is it takes wastewater, it takes sewer, it takes all the stuff you saw coming out of those pit latrines, evaporates the water, cleans it, takes the water all the way to clean drinking water standards, makes net electricity, so it powers the village that it's running from the sewage, and makes ash that's 14% phosphorus. This machine has been running for now 4 years in West Africa with like 95% uptime, and we're building a second machine now.
Many people saw a video of Bill Gates drinking water derived from human feces. We've now brought this Omni processor to Senegal, where it's doing the job that it was intended to do.
Dakar is a unique city in Senegal. You can have Africa summarize it in Dakar. It's a bad situation. In Dakar, 1.2 million people are not connected to a sewer line. They have their own facility. And when these pits are full, people can call for a mechanical emptying, but can call also for a manual emptying. Manual emptying is very dangerous. They dig a hole near the household, and they transfer the sludge to this hole. And the manual emptier is directly in contact with the sludge. When people practice manual emptying, you have some pathogen who can spread out in the environment. This is a possibility of contamination of population. Mechanical emptying is better. There's no contact between the sludge and the population, and you can transfer to treatment plant. Right now, we cannot remove the pathogen. This is why the Omni processor is very important. Thanks to this machine, we treat one third of the sludge in Dakar and make pathogen free. We produce several byproducts, electricity, drinking water, and ash. With this byproduct, we can make business from sanitation.
Les bouts de branche vont devenir excessivement intéressant. Parce que ce sera une matière première, comme je l'ai dit tout à l'heure. Ce que je peux conseiller en tout cas aux futurs entrepreneurs qui veulent faire des affaires, ils peuvent venir dans l'assainissement.
When I see this machine, my dream is to change the face of sanitation. in all Senegal, in all Africa. Drinking water is life, but sanitation is dignity.
So after we built that machine, Ice and Derek Armors came to me. And like, you guys built cow milk? And I knew the machine, the economics didn't work on a farm. The Omni processor deals with really thick materials, has a lot of solids in it. And generates net power. Cow manure was very wet. And I needed something that could process massive volumes. It had to be cheaper. So I started thinking about it. The farmers just didn't leave me alone. They called me about this a week. Hey, you got something figured out for this? After some time, I came up with a new piece of equipment. So dairy farms, it's amazing. This is the state-of-the-art technology in dairy farms. They have anaerobic digesters too, but anaerobic digesters don't get rid of one drop of water. Every drop of water that goes in, comes out. It doesn't really solve the problem. We need to solve the problem. Get rid of these lagoons, make the dairy farm zero-discharge farm. Zero-discharge dairy farm. That's the plan. So I came up with a machine, and let me kind of just briefly go through how this thing works. The concept has been around since the early 1970s, vapor recompression. It's an old thermodynamic cycle. And let me explain to you how it works. In that red box there, we boil the stuff coming in. And we make vapor, and that vapor is at 1 atmosphere of pressure. And in order to boil that water, it takes about 2,200 kilojoules of energy. Boiling water is energy intensive. But for about 50 kilojoules of energy, we can compress it to a slightly higher pressure. So we invest 50. And now we have steam that's at higher temperature and pressure, and it comes back, don't worry about the distillation thing, and it comes back in as heat to boil the incoming material. So we recover 100% of the energy that we invested in the beginning. So this machine takes really about 1/30th of the energy of boiling water directly. And at the same time, it also concentrates the ammonia. It makes clean drinking water, it makes aqueous ammonia, and it makes dry solids. And we're currently building one of these machines to go on a farm in West Texas. This is what the machine looks like. And like I said, it makes water that we can get right back to the house, which is really amazing. So there's nothing that ever leaves the farm. The aqueous ammonia solution, very interesting thing about cows. Cows are a very magical piece of equipment. So it turns out that everything that comes out the back of a cow is organic. You guys know that? Now the milk is not necessarily organic. The cow has to be in special pastures, it's got to have special food, they have all the special stuff in order to have organic milk. But its crap is always organic. Therefore, anything we make out of that is also organic. Pretty neat, huh? So we're making organic fertilizer with these cows. And this ammonia solution is about 200 times more concentrated than the ammonia that was in the original cow. All of the dry solids, these were all phosphorus. And this is another interesting thing that I didn't quite understand. But in normal cow manure, the phosphorus and the nitrogen are mixed together. So when you put it on the field, you get what you get. And usually what happens on most dairy farms is around the farm, they're way too high in phosphorus. In fact, they're reaching toxic levels of phosphorus, which is actually an EPA problem. And there's nothing they can do about it because they need more nitrogen. When we separate it in two separate containers, they can put the nitrogen where they want it, which is normally corn. Corn is going to want nitrogen. Grass is going to want nitrogen. Alfalfa wants phosphorus. So they can shift the phosphorus to where they want phosphorus, they can put the nitrogen where they want. And they're now both something that they can store indefinitely. One of the problems with manure is it's, believe it or not, perishable. Okay, it starts smelling, smoking, and doing all kinds of nasty things. I want to talk about phosphorus just for a moment.
phosphorus is actually in shorter supply than almost anything that we have on the planet. And we're using it at a very, very high rate. So being able to recycle it, not just at dairy farms, but at wastewater treatment plants, is a really huge deal that I want to focus on. But nitrogen is even a bigger deal. So we think that we have this whole sanitation thing in the United States figured out. Let's talk about what we're doing today. We have nitrogen fertilizer plants. Does anybody know how we make nitrogen fertilizers? Some chemists in here, I'm sure they do. Okay? You need hydrogen. Okay. Ammonia is NH3, so I need some hydrogen molecules. The easiest place to get hydrogen molecules is from methane, natural gas. So we take the carbon molecule, we turn it into carbon dioxide and let it go into the atmosphere. We take the hydrogen molecules, now I've got hydrogen. Okay, we get that by steam stripping natural gas. A fossil fuel, by the way. Now I need nitrogen. The easiest place to get it from is the air. We cryogenically freeze the air, turn it into liquid air, distill out the oxygen, and now I have nitrogen. And I combine the nitrogen and the hydrogen to make ammonia. Massively energy intensive, using fossil fuels and producing huge amounts of carbon dioxide. Okay? And this is what a nitrogen fertilizer factory looks like in the United States. Huge environmental impact. Okay, so we do that every day. Where does all that nitrogen go? It goes on the farmland, right? It goes on all the crops. And then eventually we eat it. It goes in the wastewater treatment plant and it ends up at that place, right? And that place destroys it. That's why we built that facility. Its whole purpose is to destroy the nitrogen. And it does it through a process called nitrification, denitrification, and at huge electrical costs. You know, megawatts of electricity flowing into our common wastewater treatment plants, and the purpose is to kill the nitrogen. And we consider this to be the gold standard in which we should continue doing for all time. So when I started looking at this VRD technology at the dairy farm side, excuse me, I started to realize that I could scale it down, scale it down, scale it down. And in fact, I'm working on a version of it right now that's a single toilet. It's a VRD unit that does just one toilet. And what's really cool about this is there's no plumbing. You just take this thing, stick it against the wall, and plug it in. It uses about 10 watts of power, and it does the same exact process. It makes distilled water that we atomize and blow out of PVC pipe off the side of your house. It makes dry solids that we can burn there, and it takes the aqueous ammonia, and that's what we use to flush the toilet. And what's really cool is this aqueous ammonia is about 8% concentration, so you never have to clean your toilet. And we get the ammonia from you, so you never have to resupply it with ammonia. It's really cool. If we scale it up one size bigger, then we recycle the water in your house. Now this concept that we all have today, that we're going to buy water from some public municipality, have pipes covering our entire city. It's interesting that we have pipes covering the entire city, and we no longer have telephone lines covering the entire city. It's a lot easier to do a wire than it is to do a pipe. Okay, but we have actually two sets of pipes. We have one set of pipes that bring the water to us, and another set of pipes that take the water away. Remember when we had mainframe computers? And we all had to plug into the mainframe? And then all of a sudden, you know, the Stephen Jobs and Bill Gates and these guys were like, hey, you know, everybody can have their own computer. Well, everybody can have their own water treatment plant right at their house. And now all of a sudden, we are decentralized. Concept, you know, people want to be off the grid with power? I don't know, maybe. But being off the grid for water is actually a lot easier, and from an economic, and from an environmental standpoint, a way better idea. And we've already proven that the technology is possible. Now we're just commercializing those ideas. This is a picture of my one concept of our little toilet. It has a bowl, and it flips upside down. We actually wash the bowl with aqueous ammonia. I'll show you something else here. So after this exercise with the Gates Foundation over the last 5 or 6 years, I started thinking to myself, this is a common human problem where we all think we're doing the right thing. We're certain that we're doing the right thing. And we're really doing the wrong thing. So this is kind of a fun little example. These guys were plowing the American plains. And they were going to town. And they really thought they had this figured out. Okay? They were plowing the native prairies at an amazing rate. And for a while, it was going really well. Okay? I mean, this guy, he's even got a little sunshade up there, right? He's kind of sitting there, he's probably got beer, drinking it, harvesting the wheat, living in high cotton. You know, they thought they had this figured out. And they do. Okay. Mother Nature struck back hard, okay, and in a way that caused them a lot of pain. Over the years, they changed the farming practices, but I don't think the harvest in that field is very good. So now I think to myself, what are we doing today that has nothing to do with water and sanitation? Let's pick a new topic. That is just, we think is all right, and maybe not so right. And it's a place where there's huge opportunity for entrepreneurship, science, chemistry, math, all of those things to come in and fix it. This seems like the right thing. Electric car. Isn't that kind of the future, electric cars? Actually, I love electric cars. I think electric cars are great. But they bring a whole slew of problems that no one has ever thought of, okay, that we are going to have to deal with. And somebody has to deal with it. Whoever does is probably going to make a lot of money and really help the environment in the process. Batteries. They're made from rare earth metals. There's a reason they call them rare earth metals, okay? They don't call them abundant earth metals. They call them rare earth metals, okay? And currently today, guess how much, what percent of the rare earth metals in batteries are recycled today? 8%. 8% of all the rare earth metals that are used in batteries are recycled today. 8%. Okay? So when we start building electric cars that have massive batteries in them, where is all this going? Okay? So turns out cobalt. Has anybody been studying cobalt? Cobalt's a huge problem. Okay. Cobalt only really exists in the Central Africa. I can't remember the name of the country. But there's a place in Central Africa. This picture is taken there where they're mining cobalt. This next picture is a little bit disturbing. This is one of the big problems with cobalt mining today in the world. And this is where we're getting all these rare earth metals that are going into all these batteries. Here's another place that looks pretty nice, pretty clean. It's an Apple store with all these beautiful new computers. What's the shelf? What's the lifespan of one of those computers? 4 years? 5 years? How long are you going to use one of those computers before you throw it away? I read that these old LED screens, some of them contain, excuse me, almost half a pound of lead in the screen. Where does all this stuff go? Okay, I'll share a picture that was taken right here in the Puget Sound. King County landfill. This is where all this stuff goes. So we use it once, crush it up, go to the landfill. Okay? Seems like a huge, huge, huge opportunity. So I want you to start thinking about recycling in a really fundamentally different way. My son has one of these cars. Lego. Lego's cool. That really was Lego. How many different parts are on there? I mean, unique pieces. Hundreds? The problem with that Lego thing is you can't hardly make anything else other than that Porsche out of those Lego pieces. If you took all these Lego parts and threw them in a big pile, you'd actually do some pretty clever more stuff. Excuse me. The problem is that if you've ever done that, you've got four or five people building something out of Legos, there's always one person in a group that takes all the good Lego pieces. We kind of have the same problem with minerals and supplies. There's only one person that takes all the good stuff. So I want you to think about Legos in a whole different category. How about if we use these Lego pieces? Those are the Lego pieces to use. Okay. You can make anything from those Legos. Okay. There is nothing you can't make. In fact, if you wanted to make one of these, okay, you can make that Lego with those pieces. Now, I'm not quite that talented. Start thinking about recycling. Not as wood, plastic, paper, steel, but think of it as carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, phosphorus. If you start thinking about recycling in that context, it changes everything. Because with enough heat and enough temperature and the right environment, we can separate everything into gold, lead, lithium, cobalt, okay? And that's the way we have to think about it. With the machines I've been building, I've been using really old technology like distillation, heat, temperature, combustion, oxidation. And by doing that, I get to separate it all out into whatever I want. And then I can recombine it in high concentrations. And then I have merchantable product, okay? Recycling is something that should allow us to have products that we can sell in high volume. One more thing you can probably build with that chart. One of these guys, I actually worked on this project quite a bit, so I like that picture. And I want you to think, this is my last slide. And this is when we think about solving problems, what's the one phrase that everyone kind of puts out there? Keep it simple, right? If you're going to solve a problem, you know, try to keep it simple, which is great. The problem is that all the simple problems have already been solved. All of the simple problems have already been solved. I promise you that the solutions that are going to fix everything that I showed on that those previous screens are not going to be simple solutions. They're going to be super complicated. And they're going to require the best chemists, the best physicists, the best business people putting together a very complex solution. Okay? That's what it's going to take. Super smart people creating a relatively complex solution. Don't confuse complexity with maturity. Okay? So, you know, the computer board that you see there, the engine, super complex. But they just work every day. You probably all drove here in a car, they'll switch on just once. Okay? And the engine probably looks like what you see on that screen there. Same with the computers, you just turn them on. So you can have a solution that is terrible, terribly complex, and incredibly reliable and cheap.
Do you think in the next few years they'll be mining the solid waste? Not the sewage, but the garbage piles.
I think the first thing they're going to do is stop putting stuff in the landfill. So the material that is being trucked every day will go to a processing facility where through heat and other mechanisms, we'll separate everything. And by the way, that's going to produce massive amounts of energy. Okay. okay, that's going to be a huge energy positive thing. I think before we go into the landfills and start mining the landfills, that's going to take a while, because the way they build a landfill is they put down a layer of garbage and a layer of dirt, a layer of garbage, a layer of dirt. So unraveling that is going to be a huge job. But I think someday we will. Apologize for my throat.
So where do you see the sedimentation technology going, say, in the next 2 years in terms of what you've developed? Is it ramping up, like, is it going to be installed various places, or is it going to be a slow?
No, I don't think it's going to be slow. Yeah. So we're building this first machine in West Texas now. We are so excited about this thing. It's just amazing. And it boils. It doesn't just boil. It evaporates 90 gallons of water a minute with a very small amount of electricity. And so we have at least 20 farms lined up behind that one. Okay, so we're, and then not just there, but in the wastewater treatment plants, in septic facilities, we see this thing going from, you know, slow to explosive in like 1 year. So yeah, we're super excited about it.
For the third world sanitation problem, I know that a lot of business models involve microloans and women-owned businesses. Is there a way for your sanitation to be downsized to the point where that could be microloaned within villages rather than built by a government in the car?
So we're working on two technologies with the Gates Foundation. One technology is the Omni processor. That is industrial scale. The other one is the household toilet.
Yeah.
The household toilet can also be two stall toilets, three stall, whatever. And it's very common in those slums that somebody owns the toilet and they charge people to use it. And usually the person that owns it is a woman who's getting paid to use it. We're also working on another technology. And so in that situation, you could definitely microfinance it. We're working on another technology, which is a miniature garbage burner that uses a fire, burns at super high temperature, makes steam, drives a little steam engine, makes electricity, and it's got a whole bunch of outlets. We think we can make these for a few $1,000. And that's something that could also be microfinanced. Now someone owns that, they're the only person in their slum that has electrical power. Okay? You bring them some garbage, they'll burn it. They'll charge you to charge your cell phone or whatever you want to do. And so we think that's a huge opportunity for people or a family to make a living and actually cleaning up the environment at the same time.
So sort of building off of that and thinking, you know, sort of how the revolution of cell phones went, that they actually were adopted quicker in developing countries. Do you think that sort of home scale or micro scale is going to take off quicker in developing countries than in America because we're so invested in our public work systems?
Yeah, absolutely. So you're right. They skip the whole landline phone. We did that for what, 100 years? They skipped that. They just went straight to cell phones. By and large, they'll skip centralized water and water treatment and go to decentralized water treatment. That's what I believe. And that's the technologies that we're working on with the Gates Foundation to bring to those countries, is get the technical solution there.
Question, so where are materials, where are we with recycling? How far along are we with recycling?
Terrible. In my opinion, terrible. Because we don't think about it in the right context. You know, I can't have, I'm pretty educated, and I can't figure out which garbage can we put in. I'm at SeaTac, and I got all these different cans there, and I'm afraid I'm going to end up in jail. I'll tell you something about SeaTac. I was there the other day, and got off the airplane, had to go to the bathroom, went to the men's room, and of course there's like 40 urinals there, and all these guys go to the bathroom. That's a lot of ammonia. They're just pissing it away. We should be recycling that. We should be concentrating that. Why is it all just going down the pipe? Like, how many bathrooms are there in SeaTac that opportunity, just going down the drain. But back to your recycling question. I think if you just go look at the garbage that's going to the landfill, and you look at the amount of stuff that we recycle, it's such a small fraction of it. You try to pick out pop cans and bottles and different things, but we do a terrible job. There's so much stuff that's going. And there's so many other technologies that I didn't have time to discuss all of them, but one of them is carbon sequestration through making biochar is something that we can get net energy out of our garbage, a lot of net energy. And we can basically make coal. And then we can bury that back in the ground and sequester that carbon for eternity in a very, very safe way that's not going to leach into the environment. Okay? And in the process, if you take something like your cell phone, it has a lot of plastic in it. We heat that thing up to about 2,000 degrees. We're going to gasify all of the plastic. All of that stuff is going to go. All of the metal, we can extract that. Okay? But there's nobody really doing that. Most of the recyclers that you see have big piles of this and big piles of that. And, but they don't have equipment that has been very, very specifically designed to actually separate these things by constituent components. There's not a lot of people even working on that kind of technology, which is, I think, really sad.
So about 5 years ago, I went to India and worked on that project that you're talking about, the sanitation project. They call it MMATSI, the Health and Sanitation Project. And I traveled across the India when I was working on that project, I was meeting a lot of like women from these villages in India, and we were trying to work on that the one restroom thing, the toilet they had in their houses, and we were trying to sell them very cheap. It was like 2,000 the model, the prototype that we worked on. That it was 2,000-3,000 rupees, which is very cheap considerably, and it's still. Those women, they didn't want it, even we were able to microfinance it or loan it to them, they didn't want it. They would still go out. So I think changing the mentality, the awareness, this is going to be a very, very big challenge for like developing countries in the world.
For certain, especially in India.
Yeah.
Part of the issue is that a lot of the toilets that we have today that are in India are not very nice. They're not clean. And so people don't want to go into a little building that smells bad, that's dirty, when they can go out in the woods where they've gone their whole life and it's clean. So it's both a technology thing and a cultural thing. I remember when I was a kid, we owned a logging company, and the old loggers, when they had to change the oil in a bulldozer, they drove it out of the shop, and just unscrewed the thing, and just let the oil just run on the ground. And my brother said, you guys can't do that anymore. You gotta catch that oil, you can't be dumping oil on the ground, that's just not environmentally friendly. Okay, so they put a pan underneath there, they opened the thing, and the oil went in the pan, and then they had two the big loggers picked up the pan and carried it outside and dumped the oil in the parking lot. We would never dream of doing that today. Okay? But these cultural things take time and you have to have persistence. But you also have to have technical solutions. There has to be someplace to put the oil. There has to be a clean toilet that they want to use. And that's been a big push, is to make toilets that don't smell bad, that are clean.
I was just going to, the notion of non-technology issues, and it's not just cultural, it could be policy-driven, it could be financing, you talk about a lot of great outputs to these things, but oftentimes there's no market for that developed, so you have to go and go beyond that. How do you think you would address building the entire life cycle, if you will?
Well, first of all, you have to pick a battle that you can fight with the resources that you have. And so I'm very careful to not fight certain battles because I would run out of money fighting those battles. One of the problems is that usually if we're doing something that's wrong, there's probably somebody that's making a lot of money doing that. Okay? And so you may hit significant opposition trying to change something because the people that are doing it the way they're doing it are making a lot of money. And the thing I'm thinking about particularly is the landfills. You know, anybody that owns a landfill in the United States makes a lot of money. And so what they will say is that if you're going to set up some other kind of facility that's going to process that garbage thermally or chemically or some other way, that you're bad for the environment, that you're going to pollute the children, and you know, you're going to get a lot of opposition.
And we have 30 years of that.
Yeah. And so what happens is that we just tend to stick with the default with what we're doing rather than go to something new. And then sometimes our own environmental community is our problem. Because anytime you do something new, you're not going to do it perfect. And there has to be some allowance to make some mistakes, to learn, to figure it out, to, you know, to evolve. Okay? If you look at like an automobile today, and you compare them to automobiles 100 years ago, they're way better today. But it took time to get there. So when we think about, you know, recycling facilities, you know, we're not going to get it perfect right out of the gate. But as a community, as you know, the policymakers, the government agencies, everybody has to support it for the long haul to get to the finish line. Otherwise, we just won't get there.
So for the pieces that you're working on, the Omni processor and the household toilet, so what do you think is the biggest challenge to expanding these of those two things?
Just manpower. I mean, when I think about the toilet, we know how to do it. And, you know, we have to be careful because we have a lot of good ideas. You know, we're working on the dairy processor, we're working on that for wastewater treatment plants, we're working on the toilet. And at the end of the day, I run out of engineers, I run out of resources. But I am certain that you will see toilets in the next 5 years that are revolutionary to anything you've ever seen before. There is no doubt. And this whole concept of having, using the water in your house one time, okay, having, not having decentralized water supply, okay, you will look back at this and go, wow, I can't believe we did that. Okay, that will happen, we're certain. But it might take 20 years before it becomes widespread. And there will be political opposition to it. So we went to a facility, I won't mention which municipality of the Pacific Northwest we went to, but we wanted to build a big apartment complex. We were like, this would be super green, okay? And we'll do it. It'll be an off-the-grid water supply. We'll reuse the water in the building over and over and over again. And the mayor's like, I got municipal bonds I gotta pay for. I got a wastewater treatment plant, and I got a public water supply, and you guys are buying me wearable services. That's not gonna work.
Have a target price for that product, a single use, a single person in the household?
I think in the United States it's going to be about $3,000. If you scale that up to the household, we think we can do a whole house for about $25,000. Okay? But what that would replace is replace a well, septic fields, all that stuff is gone. And then you have the same water you use over and over again.
When will we see it on the plane and replace all the water they have to carry and all the fuel they have to spend?
That's actually the first place you'll probably see it. Probably the very first place you'll see it is something like the space station. Because there we're recycling the water all the way back between drinking water. Absolutely. And they'll pay more than $2,500 for it.
So you mentioned, you know, your relationship with the Gates Foundation, how it started and such. Where is it now and where is that going?
It's been an interesting ride with the Gates Foundation because they're super smart people and they know so much about this, all of this global sanitation. And things that, you know, really I would have never even gone down this road if it hadn't been the Gates Foundation. But it's a little bit of a clashing of two cultures because, you know, I'm running a for-profit business and they're running a foundation. And so we often philosophically just don't see eye to eye. Because I gotta pay the bills every month, right? they got a whole bucket load of money. They never run out of money. And so what I want to do is I want to monetize ideas that we have. When we figure out how to do something, I want to sell it, make money. Because then I can hire more engineers, I can hire, get more lab equipment, it gives me more resources, right? Well, the concept that a for-profit business would make money in the United States on a donation from the foundation for something that really should be benefiting the poorest people in the world is something that they have a hard time reconciling. So, we're learning to work together, and it's been very productive. And like I said, they do a lot of really, truly amazing stuff. And so it's been an honor to work with the Gates Foundation. But it has definitely been a clash of cultures, you know, a for-profit business working with the foundation. We're learning how to work together.
So that raises any
questions?
Yes. Go ahead.
So I had a question related to that. Since you're getting a lot of your funding right now from the Gates Foundation, is there any private capital that's interested in your research?
So what we're doing on the whole dairy side is all private. The Gates Foundation is not involved in what we're doing on the dairy processor, and the whole BRD technology is all private funded. And what we're doing with the Omni processor and the toilet is all funded by the Gates Foundation. And yeah, there's a lot of interest. From a private investment.
What are they mainly interested in, those private investors? Because I was also thinking about the ash used in that for building materials and how that would impact deforestation and all kinds of other problems. Is there any interest in investing in that from private funders?
Well, we have so much interest in so many different areas. I would say that there's definitely companies that have come to us wanting to deal specifically with the nutrient outputs, okay? And they want to get in the business of buying and selling nutrients, setting them up with long contracts with these suppliers that are supplying them. One of the big problems we have in the United States right now is it's super hard to get organic nitrogen. You know, if you're, and even organic phosphorus. There's a farm that I'm working with right now has 10,000 acres of alfalfa, and they have 24,000 acres in corn and soybeans. And they simply cannot, and organic, the whole thing is organic. You go try to source that much organic fertilizer. And so those are the kind of individuals that are showing huge interest. Because it's a transformational technology that we've developed here.
How about building materials? Anyone interested in that?
You mean like the ash?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the ash in Africa has its value because it's where they need it. But in the United States, there's still enough coal-fired power plants where we have no shortage of ash. You know, so for concrete, and they use ash in concrete. But, the commercial value of it is very low. What's unique about the Omni processor is that if you take sewer sludge from a wastewater treatment plant in the United States, and you burn it, take the carbon out, what's left is 14% by concentration phosphorus. That's super, super high. If you wouldn't buck chemical fertilizer, you probably wouldn't be having more than 14%. And that's what we're getting in our ash.
Is heavy metal contamination an issue with the ash?
Not in the ash, because what's allowable by government regulation on the ash is actually, I wouldn't say it's high, but it's higher than what is allowable in the air. So for us, we've tested the ash, and our ash is considered non-hazardous. So we can put it anywhere, anytime. But mercury in the exhaust stream is a huge problem. And so it's actually one of the magical things about the Omni processor is that we dry out the fuel before we burn it. There's old sludge incinerators, and the problem is they don't dry out their sludge before they burn it. So they have water vapor in the exhaust stream, and when they cool that below 600 degrees Fahrenheit, which is kind of the point at which the mercury turns to liquid, everything turns to mud, because you have all that vapor condensing in your exhaust stream, and it just makes a big muddy mess, and you can't deal with it. So for us, since everything's dry, our mercury emissions are tiny. We meet all of the new federal regulations for mercury. But the big problem with combustion is really in the exhaust stream, not in the ash.
Question that I have is, are your organization is working something for the child labor? You know, I see already in the, you know, like the one you were showing that Apple is getting their medals from child who are doing all those things in Indonesia or other places that I was reading an article, or, you know, like other countries where they do, you know, pick their rags and stuff, child. So
in the areas where we're working, that's not a problem. Mm-hmm. So like in Senegal where we're working, mm-hmm. You know, we control those facilities. We hire everybody that's in there. They're all adults. So we're just not, we're not really involved in that. We're just not in that business anywhere in anything that we're doing. And none of the materials that we're getting, we're sourcing from there. So fortunately, we don't have to deal with that problem.
How many processors on that size of machines do you have made so far?
So you saw the first one in Africa. The second one is in Sidi Wouli right now, so we just made two. We are training a company in India to make a machine, and we're training a company in China to make a machine under direction from the Gates Foundation.
All right, well, it's right about 6:30, and we really appreciate you taking the time to present to us and answer questions, and I know you weren't feeling well, so can we give him a round of applause?